Crystal Court Hotel Lekki in Lagos in focus as the Managing Director Chief Executive Architect Maobi speaks on the offerings and the uniqueness of the hotel. Special Hair Care Industry Report takes a look at Rare Care HMO's position in the market and the definition of its offerings. This is Inside Business Africa, Africa's business news and information leader. Hello, a very good day to you and thanks for joining us. My name is Kenneth Odushola Stevenson and this is Inside Business Africa, Africa's business news and information leader. Like you may have heard on the highlight, we're going to be having a very loaded program for today just to ensure that you enjoy the next 25 minutes with us. Later on the program, we shall be talking about the Nigerian housing challenge and professionals will be speaking on this, plus other interesting issues on business, finance and the economy. Stay with Inside Business. We'll be right back after this commercial break. Welcome back. You're still Inside Business Africa, Africa's business news and information leader. Thanks for staying with us. Indeed, architect Maobi has made a remarkable achievement in the areas of architectural practice and in the construction industry, especially doing exceedingly well in design and build. Today on Inside Business, we want to unveil this important personality as he ventured into other businesses, especially the hospitality industry. Here's a very important report on architect Maobi vis-a-vis his brand, Crystal Court Hotel, Lekki. Over the years, architect Emmanuel Obi, a graduate of architecture from the famous Syracuse University, New York, United States of America, managing director and chief executive, Bofill International Limited, has become a symbol of integrity and quality in the construction sector with strings of achievement through diligence and hard work.
Well, as an architect, a little bit about myself. I'm American trained. I went to school in New York, came back 93, and I had worked in the States for a couple of years before I decided to come back to Nigeria to play my own role, per se, in the development of the country and also at the same time make some money. And more so, you want to work in an environment where you're a first-class citizen. The consequences of being a black person and working in America doesn't allow you the full potential to explore what you can do. So this country provided me the platform to grow, and that's why I came back. Architecture for me has always been something. I didn't go to school to become an architect. I went to school and I grew into being an architect because I was art inclined. I was an artist as a kid. I loved to draw. I'm very creative. So that also gave me a platform to use what I have a God-given talent to do work. And that's what's got me into architecture. Done banks. I don't think it's fair for me to begin to mention names. You know, it's not. This country is a very dicey place. We've done banks. We've done hospitals in Ikeja. We've done multiple apartment complexes. I mean, in Victoria Island. Funny enough, most of my projects have been centered within VI Lekki Parkview. Not my choice, but I've never been offered things on the island. So, I mean, on the mainland. It's basically been more on the island. It's either Lekki, it's either VI, it's either Ikoyi, and Banana Island. So, towards my last, in the last couple of years, I kind of focused into luxury apartments. And we've done quite a lot. Our brochure is there to showcase what we've done. We've didn't do much with the government. I'm one of those who probably didn't have the patience of all the politics that deals with doing government job and having to pay off and all that kind of stuff. So I didn't do much. I did one or two things with the government. I stayed mostly with the private and then the corporate bodies, and they paid my bills, so why go and start playing politics?
As an architect and a professional beaming with ideas, architect Obi has also ventured into the hospitality sector with the promise to create and sustain standard by doing things uniquely different. This is a follow-up to the success he recorded in the construction sector by building a respected brand's presence through continuously doing the right thing.
When you begin to get a certain age, it's important to begin to look at where am I going to go from here. And that seems to be most of, one of the problems most of us have. By the time you realize you're too old to be on site, and then you're not unable to pay your kids' fees or take care of yourself. So what I've done in my life is always look at the where next. And that's how the hotel came to play. Okay? Hotel for me is what can I do, relax in my old age, and you know, it's a retirement plan, yeah. So, and being an architect too, I also felt I could make the hotel look more, and that's what I've done with this boutique hotel here, which, like I told you, for me is just more like a brand in the making, you know. So, like I said, it's been an evolving, you know, and that's why I have him here today.
From architectural practice to the hospitality industry, one thing also stands out as the unique attributes of architect to be sound vision. While he ventured into the design and build, the concept to him may not necessarily produce the best result, but to ensure proper project delivery, he pursued the concept with the best team and ability, which accounted for the result recorded with every project.
Let me tell you, design build is not really the best. To be honest with you, I want to be, if you want me to give an honest answer, there are guys who are trained to design, and there are guys who are trained to build. In a utopic society, or in a society where things are done properly, the architect has no business building. The engineer builds, the architect designs. But you look at an environment where professionalism is not respected. You look at an environment where a young man comes out and begins a life, and after being going to university, realizes that he's not better than the person who didn't go to university. And he compares himself to somebody who was probably trading all that period. He's worse off. So people now make do. The architects veering into construction was not by desire. It's by need. So I veered from design into construction, design, builds. And I think that's when I really had fun. Because when I designed and built, I saw my concepts or ideas grow out of this, of the soil, and at the end of the day look exactly what I wanted, as opposed to giving it to somebody who now decides to make changes because they want to be lazy. So it's been an evolving thing, from design to design build, and from design build to consultancy. I guess age has to do with that. Hotel is a good business, but I will tell you, it's one of the most difficult businesses. A good business because it's one business that generates money every day, but that's not true. It only generates money every day if it's open if it's open for a long time. A lot of hotels close after the first year. A lot of hotels after the first year either close down or die. So for me, at a point, I found out I had an expatriate as a manager when I started, and for me that was the dream thing. Put this white man here, go back home. And I sat down and I watched my dream go down the tubes. So for me, it was decide, what are you going to do?
In line with technological advancement, the application of cutting edge technologies and innovation has become a burning issue in the construction and engineering sector. How much of these are effective and are being practiced in Nigeria in relation to our environment?
Conceptions, you know, there's lack of people developing concepts, and I think that has to do with the money. Architects are poorly paid. If I knew I was going to make so much money designing a building, I could spend 6 months trying to develop my design. But if you look at what architects are paid here, comparison to what they're paid in the civilized world, the architects realize if I spend so much time trying to develop this design, I'll be hungry. So he just copies it and churns it out. You know, like a car manufacturing factory, like an assembly line. We are very behind. We have some. But how many buildings are designed here to take advantage of the sun we have? Very few.
From construction sector to the hospitality industry, there are obvious challenges, but the ability to focus on the big picture and the vision behind the establishment makes the remarkable impact in the patronage, acceptability, and growth.
One, we don't have hospitality. You know, when we say tourism in Nigeria, we're joking. Well, hospitality is part of tourism. Like I said, I have lived in hotels. You know, there was a time in the States when I was not feeling well, and I lived in a hotel for almost a year plus. And there are things that I wasn't happy with. There are things I thought could be done better. So when I now had the opportunity to run a hotel, I think my whole goal has been, instead of complaining, now that you have a hotel, can I write those things that I found wrong in my own hotel? I think you can't run a hotel if you've never stayed in one. Lan, I realize there's something. If hotel for you is a vision, there are two things. Is a hotel a vision, or is just a business? These are two things. If it's a vision, you see it from a different point of view. If it's just a business, you just put it there and hope it survives. Mine was a vision. All my life, I've always said, I'm going to own a hotel. But you see, my business never offered me the time. It was when I started slowing down that the option came. And I jumped at it before it became too busy. And then I started it. It wasn't what I thought it was. Hospitality is very difficult, especially in a country where we don't have power. I was telling, I've always told my boys, this hotel are those two generators out there, the 150 kVA and the 100 kVA gen. When they pack up, this is no more hotel. I think there was a songwriter said that a house is not a home when there is no one. I think it was Luther Vandross. He said a house is not a home until when there's no one in there. Good. A hotel ain't a hotel if the gens are not working. Which, if you get right, you can sit down and begin to enjoy. But you have to put in so much. And what I've been doing the last three years, is putting in so much of my time. I've put in even more time here than I put in construction. Because I came in as a rookie, unaware. But because I had concept for what I wanted, it was easier for me to begin to develop a system. Because if you want to solve a problem, what happens to you is that you begin to think about how to solve it.
Crystal Court Lekki Lagos, medium-sized hotel with five-star service. Architect Obi speaks further on the offerings and the service provided.
Yeah, the Crystal Court, like I said, is, you know, the different kinds of hotels. They have the large hotel, have what they call the boutique hotels. Crystal Court is what you call a boutique hotel. We have a twin boutique hotel. A boutique hotel is actually what you call a cottage hotel in overseas. Small, nice, homely. And that's what we've tried to do here. I'll give you an example. I don't have a club. I don't have an external restaurant. I don't have people hanging around at night, noise. This is strictly a home. The restaurant downstairs only services my guests. The lounge downstairs only services my guests. We have a private restaurant, strictly for guests, a bar, a lounge. We have a pool side with TV and everything. You can sit down and watch TV. We have a beautiful gym. We even have a space where you can walk if you feel like taking a walk, you know, exercising your body. We have a small business center, you know, where you can, you know, do some work. It's a small little town. We even have, you'll be surprised. You can see green everywhere. I have courtyards with green. I can boast of my green. I call my hotel an oasis of green in a concrete jungle called Lekki. And you can tell, once you open that gate, you can come and see for yourself.
Well, indeed, congratulations, Architect Imao Obi, for doing the nation proud, especially the architectural practice and the profession in Nigeria. We believe you're going to do very well, especially in the hospitality industry, replicating what you've done in the housing and environment sector of Nigeria. Moving on now on today's edition of the program, let's talk about the issue of HMO, health care industry. The health maintenance organizations are doing exceedingly well, and Nigerian government, especially the President Muhammadu Buhari's administration, has promised to change the dynamics in terms of how this sector performs. Redcare HMO has the best offerings around and also making the best mark in terms of provision of healthcare services. Take a listen to this report.
The success of any idea or business is determined by how well it resonates with consumers. While the initial stages necessitate a considerable push from the business until the idea finally hooks consumers, ultimately, it needs to evoke substantial interest to drive adoption. Typically, this journey is marked by 3 to 4 stages, sending off the ideas, building interest, recall, and ultimate adoption, followed by consumer loyalty. Basically, the critical shift replacing the initial push from business to the ultimate pull from the consumer is what will determine the success. How then do we define the current scenario with the healthcare insurance sector in Nigeria against the backdrop of the stakeholders' perception?
Well, Redcare HMO is the fastest growing HMO in Nigeria at the moment. Our mandate is to be that HMO that stands out in terms of infrastructure, human capital, technology, and also our processes. We're doing a lot within the health insurance space. We're a duly registered limited liability company. We're accredited by the National Health Insurance Scheme, which is actually our regulatory body. We've been in operation going to the decade now. And we do have a very large coverage within both, especially in the formal sector. We're doing a lot. And well, you see, the thing is, it's not, I think it's, right now, it's not even necessarily about the conviction, because there's a difference between wants and needs, and there's I know in psychology there's Abraham Maslow's scale of needs, the preferences, you know, where you go on the different levels. So there are certain things that are luxurious products or services. There's a lot of expectation internally for us. We're doing a continuous process improvement, we're doing a lot of tweaking, we're doing a lot of design, we're doing a lot of strategizing, we're building a larger workforce, we have the infrastructure, we have the technology, we have the human capital. We're lacing the industry and we're trying to be the game changers and be the pace setters for the industry.
Yes, the health insurance industry in particular, for the longest time, it has been predominantly a push category, with health insurance players adopting different channels and strategies to drive health insurance adoption among consumers. It is only recently that there has been a gradual shift. The increasing demand for health insurance from consumers is steadily changing the industry dynamics. Mr. Tunde Salako, Managing Director, Chief Executive, Redcare HMO, speaks further on the performance and the Redcare strategic preparation and position in the industry.
Okay, well, the thing is, it's quite interesting, and there's a lot happening that is very, it's interesting. It's quite amazing because you're leveraging on numbers. Again, insurance is we're pulling risk together. We're pulling a lot of numbers, and you're having pretty much the healthy majority paying for the unhealthy minority. So when you're pulling the risk together and you're pulling crowd together, what is very key is being able to actualize each pool that you're bringing together. So you have different population samples and population sizes. And as a result, you're looking at what is peculiar to each age group, for example. And you're factoring age, you're factoring sex, you're factoring the location, where, Abuja is a different terrain from Lagos, so is Port Harcourt. You're factoring in the nature of work an individual is having. You're also factoring in the kind of hospital or kind of care the person wants to access. Well, I think the stringent and quality measures are being put in place at the moment. I know that the current administration is doing a lot in that regard, especially in making sure that all the HMOs cross their T's and dot their I's in terms of funding, in terms of disbursements in the hospitals, in terms of, you know, pretty much the operational process. Let's even take the business aspect aside, the operational process of being a valid and concerned HMO. I know there's a lot going on. We're being given the meetings and fora, which are being organized more regularly, and they're doing the NHS is doing a lot to make sure that
From products and services, relationship with caregivers and implement suppliers, capacity building and finance, the health insurance scheme requires strict marketing and development strategies that must be adaptable to the country and the economy. What is the position of Red Care HMO and opportunities, especially in the informal sector?
Okay, well, the thing is, the concept of managed care, which was officially enacted in Nigeria in 2005 by the National Health Insurance Scheme, being the regulator, he's actually been in the system for a while. And even from the states where it originated, what is very important, going back to your question, is it's different mechanisms, different models, but what is adoptable to our own system? Because Nigeria's demography is different from other countries, and so you have to use mechanisms or models. You can imbibe them, you can adopt them, but you have to, you know, cultivate them to blend with the peculiarities of your own system. Okay, I think that goes in as a spin-off to the earlier conversation we were just having. The thing is, it's based on, I mean, they're different. For example, we at Red Care HMO have different products and a wide range and bouquet of services that at the end of the day, it wouldn't make sense for you not to take one. They're very robust. They've been customized and designed, even though we present them as generic, but they've been designed in such a way that there's something that is specific to your own industry where you work in or to you as an individual.
Double taxation will come in the sense that you are in country A and country B. Nigeria, I'm operating in Nigeria. I've been taxed the same source of income here, and also I'm being taxed in the same source of income in another country. That's why most countries try to have a double taxation treaty. So that you have a treaty with this country that is that okay, for this particular tax that has been taxed here will not be taxed here or will be taxed at this particular rate. So that's the total taxation. Okay. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Sir.
So bad, and the effect is more like it discourages business, because if I know that the business I'm doing is going to, we call it double taxation. And don't forget, the taxation is a cash outflow automatically and also has a legal effect that you cannot evade tax. So its effect is so substantial, it's damaging to your business. When you're talking of multiple taxation, which is something like somebody saying now that I'm going to tax you on A in the same locality. Look at what they are doing. The state government tax you on this. The local government tax you on the same thing. So when you look at it, yes, when you look at it, multiple taxation. And we have a law to back it up and say, this is what expected state government should tax. This is what local government should tax. But you find out that most of the time they don't abide with it. It's like you are going on the road today. Somebody just meet you on the road and say, "Let me see your tax clearance, or have you paid your tax?" Whereas normal is local government people. They just Normal is supposed to be the state government, internal revenue, that could collect that one. But especially in most villages or places outside Lagos, if you go outside Lagos, you encounter all this kind of multiculturalization, even Lagos in some few places. So it hampers business. It's destructive. Nobody normally likes to pay tax. But you pay tax because you know it's an obligation on your part, so that government also can do what they are expected, and that is tax that government use to generate revenue.
Well, when you say double taxation, I believe you mean taxing a subject more than once.
Yes, sir.
On the same issue.
Yes.
Generally, yes, it will create more revenue for government, but it will be a discourager to the taxpayer. When a taxpayer is doubly taxed, of course, he will be discouraged, and it will encourage tax evasion, tax avoidance. He will do everything not to pay because he will feel cheated. So as much as possible, double taxation should be discouraged or stopped in its entirety.
Indeed, that's about all we have time for on Inside Business Africa for today. We want to thank you very much indeed for sharing your time with us for today, and also looking at the performance of Crystal Court Hotel, Lekki Lagos, and HMOs in Nigeria. It's been Kenneth Odushola Stevenson presenting Inside Business. Thank you again for watching. See you next time.